So may I repeat once more the title of my talk on a new concept of local quantum field. This talk is based on the theorems developed together with Alexander Sorin, Matei Mateo, Vasily. Our last publication is towards a maximum mass model. So this is some very good intersection with my talk. Sorry. I'd like to start with the following statement. Everybody knows that the notion of elementary particle supposes that in accordance with the present experimental data, elementary particles do not have a composite structure by definition. And therefore, they're described by local quantum fields. Local fields, after quantization, local quantum fields. The modern theory of elementary particles is known as a standard model, or shortly SM. The best of finite numbers of fields, I mean local quantum fields, everybody knows about these fields. I'd like to stress, first of all, that one of the most important characteristics of an elementary particle is its mass. In the standard model, there is a great variety in mass value. For example, T quark is more than 300,000 times heavier than the electron. And the question arises, actually, up to what values of mass one may apply the concept of the local quantum field. I would like to stress the following moment, that in contemporary quantum field theory, you can consider arbitrary heavy quanta. So this scheme is logically perfect, even when one suggests that mass of particle is so heavy as cars, for example. This is tautology, but formally speaking, I can apply the Lagrangian quantum field theory to arbitrary heavy objects. No limits. Maybe this moment is the actual field of the theory. This is our main hypothesis. And key idea is that mass of elementary particles, so masses of objects which described by local fields has to be cut off at certain value. Let's call this upper limit of masses M capital. So there is some cutoff of mass spectrum of elementary particles described by local fields, described by local quantum fields. This is main hypothesis, main statement. And we consider it as a new fundamental principle of nature, which similar to the relativistic and quantum postulates, should underlie quantum field theory. But of course, it's practically evident that new universal physical constant with dimension of m is not only, as in our case, the maximum value of particle mass, but also plays the role of new high energy scale from dimension reasoning. And we should show this parameter for this reason, the fundamental mass. Some historical remark. Moisey Alexandrovich Markov pioneered the hypothesis according to which the mass spectrum of the elementary particles should be cut off as the Planck mass, so 10 to 19 GeV. he pulled such he pulled particles with maximum value of mass maximals and considered influence of the existence of maximums to quantum field theory, considered also the scenario of early universe using these notions and so on. But I would like to stress that Markov's original condition about the existence of upper limit for masses was purely phenomenological, and he used even standard field theoretical techniques for describing of maximum itself. Nevertheless, this new principle will hold this Markov condition. Let's start the construction of new quantum field theory, which is based on Markov's condition. And let's use the simplest example, the most simple example, free theory of the neutral scalar field. You can recognize here a Klein-Gordon equation. Klein-Gordon equation after standard Fourier transform. We obtain this equation in the momentum representation, and from geometrical point of view, mass m is the radius of mass shell upper colloid, this one, and field phi is defined on this surface. In the Minkowski momentum space, one can may embed upper colloids of this type with arbitrary radius m. This is in some intrinsic connection with the discussion in the beginning of my talk. No natural limits for value of mass. And now the question is, how we can modify the equation of motion to take into account Markov condition. I hope that there will be some analogy with case of special relativity, where this inequality one can see practically everywhere in the special relativity. What about this case? I would like to emphasize that in special relativity there exists some geometrical very deep geometrical idea. Relativization of three-dimensional velocity space is equivalent to the transition in the space from Euclidean geometry to Lobachevsky geometry, which is realized on the upper sheet of this hyperboloid. And now let's proceed in a similar way and substitute four-dimensional Minkowski momentum space by the next geometry, very close geometry with respect to Minkowski momentum space, so-called anti-de Sitter geometry or anti-de Sitter momentum space, which is realized. Can I put higher this? No. So this is five-dimensional hyperboloid. So the first surface of this hyperboloid is four-dimensional manifold, and this is the realization of so-called anti-de Sitter space, four-dimensional anti-de Sitter space, and this quantity for free particle, this is mass square, and so small m square is less than capital M square. So Markov principle is fulfilled for free particles. Unfortunately, I should use Planck. So, what we have? If we have some field, scalar field, in this intermodular space, so this construction is very useful because this delta function controls the validity of this inter. Is
minus, job. Minus m squared. M. But sure. M.
Oh, sorry. Thank you very much. Important. Because I'm in a hurry. So, this is filled. And it turns out that, as a matter of fact, we have a new degree of freedom, sine of this p phi. Because p phi squared is defined by the value of four dimensional part of this expression. So p phi squared is fixed by the value of four momentum. But sine of p phi is a new degree of freedom. And therefore, I can write my field in the following way, following form. So let's pay attention. Sine of p phi is a new degree of freedom. And for free field, mass is open to Markov condition. All right, next one. According to experimental data, the relation between energy, momentum, momentum and mass is valid and measured with highest accuracy. And therefore, I would suppose that normal Klein-Gordon equation is true for this field. But this old Klein-Gordon equation, this one, doesn't contain any information about new degree of freedom, sine of p phi, and also no any indication on the validity of Markov's principle. And the main point is the following. Unfortunately, it cannot be seen.
Something cannot be seen here.
Yes.
Okay, we should
go. No, but something is visible, right? The point is. So, this is Klein-Gordon equation, okay? Let's decompose this operator in some product of two brackets. Cos mu p5 plus minus m cos mu by p5. Where cos mu is this square root, because Markov principle is valid, and this one are identical. So using this theta surface, one can split this Klein-Gordon equation in such a product. I'll add it up, but without matrices. And now let's use one of these brackets as a new Klein-Gordon operator. It's not visible here. But, okay. This is new Klein-Gordon equation. Now you can see that sine of p5 is visible, and validity of Markov's principle is also visible. So this is new Klein-Gordon equation, and this new equation of motion for our field in the Sitterian moment in space.
The cosine of mu is always positive. Is always positive, right?
Yes. Normal arithmetical square root. And now let's solve this equation. When p5 is positive, we obtain as a solution this this row. When P5 is negative, this bracket cannot is negative, completely negative, and so phi 2 corresponding to negative P5 is equal to 0. So we have the same degrees of number of degrees of freedom as in normal theory. But on the mass shell, off the mass shell, both degrees of freedom are working. And so the interaction picture is modified. Historical remark. Some models of quantum field theory with the momentum space of constant curvature, or the Sitter momentum space, were instigated by Harald Snyder, Jan Janin, Yuri Abramovich Wolfgang in this physical institute, Igor Evgenievich Tam, and veterans remember that academician Tam considered quantum field theory with Riemannian p-space geometry, with arbitrary curve p-space geometry. Historical remark. Furthermore, I would like to use so-called Euclidean formulation of the theory because it's technically much more simple, but this is very much interesting for many physical problems. Therefore, normal trick for passing to Euclidean description, and instead of empty de Sitter p-space, we have just de Sitter p-space, and is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, square of Euclidean 4 momentum, P5 is square root plus minus, and instead of this decomposition, we have very similar decomposition, but of Euclidean Klein-Gordon operator. So we have, so let me be more short, and this integral plays the role of action integral in this formalism in Euclidean terms. And it turns out that one can write down this four-dimensional integral in five-dimensional form. So it's identity. This is new Klein-Gordon operator. The next question is, what about Fourier transform and configuration representation of new formalism? Till now, we were working in terms of momentum. Now it's already time to do some Fourier transform. First of all, let's note that in the basic Sitterian, on the basic Sitterian surface, all components of five momenta are considered on the equal footing, actually, up to some sign. And unfortunately, I should write it. Therefore, I can undergo this expression to five-dimensional Fourier transform. Here you are. Five-dimensional Fourier transform. So, no time, unfortunately. And what is important? That actually this five-dimensional Fourier integral, no, that's now vector function k the Sitterian vector function phi five-dimensional Fourier transform. Okay? And it's visible that this function is a solution of five-dimensional Klein-Gordon equation. You can see this equation here.
Yeah, just the box might be.
Yes. So, By the way, this is a hyperbolic type equation, and x5 plays the role of time. So one can consider the so-called Cauchy problem using this equation. And integration in this five-dimensional in integration over p5 in this integral gives such an expression. And this is very useful, derivatives with respect to x5. And we can consider the inverse transformations. Everything is evident here. So we have Fourier transform with one more axis, so one more dimension. More or less.
You went one. Should we go one, three, one transparency back?
Yeah.
Or one transparency.
Just a second. This one.
Is that what you mean? Or because
excuse me. Yes, I can
transparency at the time.
Ah, okay, okay. But it's easy to see that so-called Cauchy data for this variable. So phi at x equal x5 equals 0 and the derivative with respect to x5 at x5 equals 0 we call it chi of x and normal four-dimensional integral. And phi1 and phi2 are this fields, solutions of Klein-Gordon equation for positive and negative p5. So, in the result, one can obtain the action corresponding to this equation, where it is, corresponding to our Klein-Gordon equation, u1. And this action is written in terms of two local fields. This one, Cauchy data, and this is classical part, and this is the new part, depending on chi and phi. And it turns out that chi field, okay, chi field has no kinetic term in this action. And cos mu is regulating the validity of Markov principle. So you can see local Lagrangian containing fundamental mass M, containing cos for control of Markov principle, and may stress this point once more, no kinetic term for this field. This field is Fourier transform of difference between phi1 and phi2. So locality is preserved. Markov principle is valid. So everything is okay, and we can go ahead. Its correspondence principle is okay when m tends to infinity. This is some illustration of scalar theory with interaction in these terms.
Unfortunately,
let's consider such a Lagrangian which depends on fundamental mass, depends on two fields, phi and chi, without kinetic term for chi. And this is the interaction term. And this Lagrangian is invariant with respect to discrete symmetry transformation. And so there is some effect of spontaneous symmetry breaking. After spontaneous symmetry breaking mechanism, when this mechanism is working, the result we obtain mass for our particle, this one, and this mass is satisfied to Markov principle. This is so-called flat limit, when curvatures g goes to zero, curvature of the sitter space. So when m tends to infinity. Some example.
Sorry, m in Lagrangian and m in the last transparency are the same?
M capital or m small?
No, m small.
M small,
small in Lagrangian and this mass in the last transparency.
No, in just in, no, no. M
the same, the same.
No, no, no m. Small one, no. You can know in Lagrangian. Sorry. Very shortly, this is action for electromagnetic field. Also local, electromagnetic potential is 5 vector. This some, not some, this very, evident, it's evident that this action of Lagrangian density is invariant with respect to gauge transformations. This one in 5 dimensions, and as a matter of fact, we can construct. I have no time, and unfortunately, no transparencies. I wanted to demonstrate you scalar electrodynamics. So, scalar charge field interacting with electromagnetic field in this term. Unfortunately, let's go. Oh, sorry. This is some algorithm of construction of this. This Lagrangian of scalar electrodynamics, but I miss it. In conclusion, I'd like to discuss some peculiar feature of the new version of Euclidean fermion theory in these terms. So, new concept of fermion field, as a matter of fact. In ordinary formalism, in Euclidean terms, one have normal Euclidean Dirac operator. This such a decomposition of Klein-Gordon, Euclidean Klein-Gordon operator. One of this bracket is Dirac operator. And let's repeat this procedure in our case. Unfortunately, it's invisible, yeah? I should split this new Klein-Gordon operator. I should write down this as a product of two Dirac-like brackets. It turns out that it's visible. This is candidate for Dirac operator in our scheme. Sine, depending on mu, sine over mu over 2, gamma 5. Here you have no gamma 5, but so-called flat limit of this new Dirac operator when m capital tends to infinity gives you the old operator. So. Let me go over here. Maybe it's the most important thing that in spite of this decomposition with plus minus the same, you've seen sine with mu over 2. So besides of this decomposition, we have in our scheme one more decomposition a la Dirac. So one more Dirac operator with cos. So For example, I can take this operator as a new, let's call this new Dirac operator D exotic, or I can use this bracket, this operator, to build the new version, absolutely exotic, of Dirac field theory. And this is a gift of the destiny in this game. And contrary to the normal Dirac operator, this new D exotic does not have a limit when M capital tends to infinity. And therefore, we call it exotic field. And this is the main statement. It's very tempting to think that the quantum of the exotic fermion field have a direct relation to the structure of the dark matter. Because in the normal standard model, no place, no operator, no equation, no Lagrangian, no piece of Lagrangian for dark matter. Here we have absolutely new Dirac-like field. We call it the exotic. And practically, this is the end of this. When one write down I use this. This is the entropy space. Okay? Using five Dirac matrices, I can decompose this operator in such a way, a product of two Dirac operator, but completely symmetrical with respect to all components of momentum. It's evident. Yeah? And the question arises, what's the meaning of this projection operator which are constructing the help of these brackets? It's evident that we have the possibility to use projection, new projection operator with absolute disjectivian nature. And the normal Dirac field can be splitting in two fields. It can be written down as the sum of two fields, CR and CL. So the question arises, what is the sense of, what is the matter, what is the sense of this new projection operator? And it turns out that this operator are chirality operator in the new scheme. And in the flat limit, when M capital tends to infinity, we obtain normal chirality operator from this new operator. And I can say that new chirality depends on energy and momentum. This is the point. And this can be experimentally checked. It's the end of my talk. The new geometrical concept of chirality allows to think that the parity violation in weak interaction discovered more than 50 years ago was a manifestation of this disjectivian nature of momentum for space. According to our logic. And may I stress that the main purpose of the present talk was to demonstrate that there exists a local field formalism intrinsically consistent with Markov condition, this one. And this formalism is local, covariant. Euclidean Euclidean invariance, or it's possible to build everything in terms of Lorentz invariant quantity. And important point that non-trivial generalization of the standard model containing the fundamental mass M is in progress. And according to our estimations, M capital cannot be bigger, considerably bigger than 1 TeV. So it's estimation from, for example, G minus 2 experiment. Sorry, it's okay. Instead of epilogue, experiment is equal to geometry plus physics. So we hope that this geometry will be visible experimentally. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Questions, please.
As I understand, the fifth momentum cognate P5 is here considered as some auxiliary cognate. But is it possible?
Lagrangian means sine.
Yes, sine. I consider it like one sine. Is it possible to consider the physical additional as a momentum conjugate to X5, which is physically has physical sense and which is cycle, small in size, like for example second time, which was discussed now with quantum gravity by Volovich. So to consider its physically and a small size as considered in common supply models.
I can answer that it will be another theory, different theory. So in this approach, P5 is auxiliary, you are correct, but sine of P5 is very essential because you have pair of field, phi 1, phi 2, or phi and chi. In this representation, X5 allows you to formulate the Cauchy problem. This is very important because instead of this function of five variables, you can consider initial condition, initial values, phi and chi, normal functions defined in four-dimensional X space. So so-called correctness of Cauchy problem is very important here. This equation is hyperbolic time equation.
Any other questions?
With a complete set of states, will it be cut off someplace? Because it goes to infinity, a complete set of states. It's a mass state from the
mass is bounded from above, but E square is not bounded. So no cutoff of complete set of states.
Other questions? Well, as soon as you started doing something with the momentum space, I was actually expecting that pathologists would appear as soon as you come back to the configuration space. But it seems that all pathologists have been taken over by the presentation itself. Nothing was quite clear. Mm-hmm. So it's not, there are no negative norm states, no nothing.
No. It's normal theory. Normal theory with some extra terms in interaction, depending on M capital.
And how you, when you consider spinners, how much you sort of multiply the number of spinners? You double spinners as well? You have twice as many spinners?
You're talking about Euclidean formulation of spinner theory. Yeah. There exist, as you know, several ways. Several possibilities. One described by Schwinger, for example. And in Schwinger formulation, you have doubling of the spinner components. Now we prefer so-called Osterwalder-Schrader formulation. So we have the following situation. Conjugated spinner has nothing to do with the initial one. And no hermeticity, for example, but it's very comfortable because for Grassmann variables it doesn't matter. So, you understand what I mean?
Yeah. I'm afraid we are very much behind the schedule, so let's thank the speaker again.